Sorry about that. I actually have two, Joni.
Okay.
I bring handbells, of course, at a couple of different other churches. And this morning it was at First United Methodist Church. They are having a Seder Supper on Maundy Thursday. So that's April 6th. It will be at 6 p.m. They would like reservations if you would like to be involved. By Wednesday, March 29th. If you're interested, I will put this on the bulletin board out there. It gives you a phone number or an online information that you can do. I don't know if you've ever been involved in a Seder meal before. It's not what you would call a yummy supper, because of course it is the day of when Christ was crucified. So it involves eating bitter herbs, but it is a wonderful, wonderful meal to be involved in. So I would invite you and strongly urge you to go and participate. So the rest of this now is back to one great hour of sharing. We are once again this morning with a moment for mission. This is called a new day for farm workers. Lupe Gonzalo understands all too well the hard scrabble life of a farm worker. She often had to wake up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning to travel to a farm, where she was handed a bucket and told to fill that bucket as many times as humanly possible during the day. "That's your job," she said. "That's what you're there to do. And when you're doing this work, sometimes you aren't given the time to stop, to take a break, to drink some water, to just gather yourself. While all farm workers are subject to exploitation, women are especially vulnerable. For farm worker women, one of the main things that they have faced is sexual harassment and sexual violence in the workplace, which can be verbal, but also physical," Lupe said. "The women don't really have an option of speaking out for themselves, because often if you do, you run the risk of losing your job. And if you lose that job, you're not able to put food on your family's table. But Lupe's and thousands of farm workers' lives were made better thanks to the Coalition of Imakali Workers, a worker-based human rights organization. It is in partner with the Presbyterian Hunger Program, a mission supported by our gifts to One Great Hour of Sharing. One Great Hour of Sharing's purpose of helping neighbors in need around the world remains constant, giving us a tangible way to share God's love, not only through the ministries of the Presbyterian Hunger Program, but also Presbyterian Disaster Assistance and Self-Development of People. Accompanying the Coalition of Imakali Workers as they struggle to bring safety and justice to the fields where our food is grown, I believe is a perfect way to actualize our commitment to being a Matthew 25 denomination," said Andrew Kane Bartlett, representing the Presbyterian Hunger Program. If you're interested in more information on Matthew 5 denomination, look it up, please, on your websites. Farm workers face daily hardships rooted in racism, sexism, and poverty, and our solidarity with them is a clear demonstration of our beliefs. For us farm workers, the support from Presbyterians across the country has meant the world to us, said Lupe. It has meant that we don't feel like we're alone, and that we're not just demanding dignity and human rights, but that human rights need to be guaranteed, and we're walking the walk together. Presbyterians have fasted with us. They've marched with us. It has been through the collective action that we've been able to demand together a new day for farm workers. It's a new day because we are the church together. And when we all do a little, it adds up to a lot.
Thank you, Deanna. We know that to be true. When we all do a little, it adds up to a lot. Any other announcements? Let us remember then that it is God who woke us up this morning, who put this desire in our hearts to come and worship together. So prepare your hearts to celebrate God.
Please rise for the call to worship. Come into God's presence with thanksgiving.
Let us sing to the rock of our salvation.
Even in the deserts of our lives,
God is among us.
Come, let us worship and bow down.
Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
And now let's join together as we sing hymn number 60, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Once
assurance of pardon. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
talk to us at school. Wonderful. You're teaching them stuff. Yay. Well, Jameson, you teach us how we can be forgiving too, just by teaching us how to say sorry and thank you. So thank you. Shall we pray? Let's pray. Dear God, we all mess up sometimes. We all make mistakes that hurt someone else or even hurt ourselves. But you come to us, you see what we did, and you love us anyway, and you forgive us. So we thank you, God, and we pray that you would help us to keep saying that we're sorry too. In Jesus' name.
The Old Testament scripture reading is Psalm 95, which can be found on page 550 of the Pew Bible. It's entitled, A Call to Worship and Obedience. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land which his hands have formed. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Do not harden your hearts as at Meribah, as on the day of Massah in the wilderness, when your ancestors tested me and put me to the proof, though they had seen my work. For 40 years I loathed that generation and said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they do not regard my ways. Therefore, in my anger I swore, they shall not enter my rest.
Thank you, Gary. Our New Testament reading comes from the Gospel according to John. And we're in chapter 4, verses 5 through 42. That sounds like a lot, but it's a story, so it goes a little easier. Let's hear from the Word of God. So Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar. It was near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" For Jews did not share things in common with Samaritans. And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to Jesus, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for You have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you've said is true. The woman said to him, Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one who is speaking to you. Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, What do you want? Or why are you speaking with her? Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he? They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, Rabbi, eat something. But Jesus said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples said to one another, Surely no one has brought him something to eat. Jesus said to them, My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked Jesus to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, It is no longer because of what you have said that we believe, for we have heard this ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. The word of the Lord. Lord, let us hear your word. Understand your word and live your word. Amen. Excuse me. How did you learn about God? Many of us were taught who God is at church when we were children. We heard the stories about Adam and Eve, or about Daniel in the lion's den, or about David using a slingshot to kill Goliath. Our parents told us that faith was important, so it was a part of our lives. But when did you really learn about God? It's one thing to hear the biblical stories, but it's quite another to live in this world and to wonder. The woman at the well this morning in our scripture had always heard about God. Though the Jews and the Samaritans disagreed about a lot of things, they did both believe in one God, Yahweh. But like churches today, they had different opinions about worship. There were other differences, but their main issue was about where to worship. We know that the Jews believed that the temple in Jerusalem was where God's holy dwelling was located. But the Samaritans were adamant that God's holy dwelling was on Mount Gerizim. And this difference of opinion and others was so strong that these two groups had nothing to do with one another. We can all think of some churches today that are similar. The way that we interpret the Word of God either unites us or divides us. So this Samaritan woman had always been taught about God. She was even familiar with this disagreement about the mountain versus the temple. But had this woman ever really felt God before in a real way? We're told that she came to the well at noon. And this might be seemingly unimportant, but actually, that fact alone reveals a lot about the Samaritan woman. Noon, as we know, is the hottest time of the day. The other women had been long gone because they went early in the morning when it was cool, and they went together with their jugs to fill up the water. But this woman wasn't welcome with them. To avoid them, she carried her jug in the hottest time of the day. I don't know her, obviously, but I think I know something about her. I think this woman was desperate for love. You could even say thirsty for love. According to Jesus, she had been married 5 times before, and the man who she was currently with wasn't even her husband. And it wouldn't have been easy to judge her, because her problem isn't the same one that most people have. It wasn't just unusual then, it's to this day uncommon to have been married 5 times. And it might have been easy to write this woman off as a bad person who made bad choices. I mean, it wasn't just once, it wasn't just twice, it was 5 times. I'm sure the people thought that she deserved to be by herself in the heat of the day, because what she did was clearly wrong. And this woman definitely didn't expect to encounter a Jewish man at the well. In fact, she was probably scared. Not only would the Jewish man normally have avoided her, but they might have possibly insulted her, possibly even hurt her. So it would have been shocking when this Jewish man not only spoke to her, but he asked her for a drink. He didn't even have a jug. So what did he mean by that? Did the Jewish man mean he was going to put his mouth on the same jug that she put her mouth on? Couldn't imagine. And then it seems like Jesus is speaking to her these riddles about living water. But when he asked her to drink from her jug, Jesus indicated a lot more than what his words were saying. With just that simple request, Jesus told this woman that he wasn't judging her. Just by asking to put his mouth on the same jug as hers, he told her that she was worthy, that she had value, that she mattered, that not only was she worth speaking to, but she was worth saving. And that woman's experience with Jesus that day became her sermon. Jesus saw her, and even though what he saw was sin, he loved her anyway. And because of that, the Samaritan woman ran to town to tell everyone about the living water that saved her. The Gospel of John continues on to tell us that because of her story, many people believed. They, in fact, ran to meet Jesus for themselves. They begged him to stay in that Samaritan city. It says he stayed 2 days. Jesus stayed two whole days in an area where a Jew would have never gone. Because of this one woman, because of her story, many people's lives were transformed in those 2 days. And that is how we get to see God work, through individual people, through our stories. When we experience God, we want to tell others about what we've experienced. I mean, the Bible is a continuous story of these people, the Israelites, who experienced God. They were touched by the Holy Spirit, and they shared their stories, which still exist today. Not so that we can learn about David and Goliath, but no, so that we can learn about God, God who equips the young man to face down the giant. Through this unlikely character, this unlikely Samaritan woman, and this unlikely location, this story reveals God to us. It reveals that God still loves us when we are sinners, that Jesus did not come to this woman in judgment, but instead he offered her a new way, a new life. Because he came with generosity and grace, this woman's life was changed. That's the way that God loves to work, through grace, not through punishment. This grace is a free gift, and when a person is far away from God, God comes to them, and God brings that gift again. God is the one who gives to us. We don't have to earn anything from him. Jesus told the woman that she could have water, that with one drink, she would never be thirsty again. And that's exactly what God does in our own lives. We don't have to work hard to have a relationship with him. God is the one who gives us what we need every day. The spiritual water that Jesus spoke of will always fill us. Even when life is difficult or painful, we can get through those times because Jesus continually springs up inside of us. The water that the woman had come to draw had to be obtained with hard labor in the sun. But the refreshing water from Jesus is simply a gift. We don't have to strive in difficulty and struggle, but instead it just bubbles up from within us. When we depend just on meeting our physical needs, just on quenching our thirst, we'll always be thirsty. And Jesus shows us that if we don't acknowledge our need for the spiritual water, we'll always be looking in the wrong places to satisfy our longing. Another thing that we have learned about God from this story is that he reaches out to us through the words of other people. We know that Jesus didn't spend those 2 days in Samaria telling each person what he knew about their lives, like he did with this woman. Instead, her encounter, her experience, was all it took for others to hear and to believe. Sometimes we want to have our own miracle story, or we hear people say, I'll believe in God when something like that happens to me. When he comes to me and tells me things like he did to the Samaritan woman. But sometimes we do have to learn from the stories of others that God brings his children back to him through the testimony of other people. And if we know that God uses stories to reach his loved ones, all of us, with this good news, then we need to continuously look at our own stories. Have we told everyone we know about how God came to us when we were in need, when we were at a dark time in our lives, and God gave us hope? Is there someone you can think of right now who could benefit from hearing your story about how God worked through your life at different times? I'm sure there is. When we look back and see God's hand at work in our lives, we have new strength to face whatever is coming next. And we can hand that faith and that strength to other people just by telling them about our own encounters. That the God who helps us through our desperate times is always the object of our current faith. That whether we have goosebumps and miraculous moments like this woman at the well or not, we are not alone. And we see that through each other and through each other's stories. So may God give you courage today to share your story with the folks who need to hear it. And may you also be quenched by this living water. All glory, honor, and praise is yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Pastor Joni. And now let's rise and join together as we affirm our faith. To be reconciled to God is to be sent into the world as God's reconciling community. This community, the Church Universal, is entrusted with God's message of reconciliation and shares God's labor of healing the enmities which separate people from God and from each other. Christ has called the Church to this mission and given it the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Church maintains continuity with the apostles and with Israel by faithful obedience to his call. Let's join together as we sing hymn number 115, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
she was going to be here that day. She hasn't been to church in probably 25 years, and she remembered it. So, anyway, I have the opportunity to ask all of you what we want to talk to God about this morning. What worries or concerns are on your hearts, or joys or celebrations to share with each other? Well, I know that some of you have things on your hearts that we can lift up privately and silently as we pray. King of Kings, Mighty God, Holy One, our scripture this morning shows us that people have always disagreed about different parts of how to worship, but you cut through all of the debates and you go straight to the source of grace, and you reassure us that you love so much that it's not in spite of our sin, but even because we are helpless, that you love us, that you reach out and you redeem us and you save us, that we don't have to clean up our own mess first, but that you, Lord, find us when we are hiding, when we are lost. You come to us and you reveal our need. Our need is not for all of the things that we think will fill us up, but instead only for you. So we come to you with our empty jugs this morning, God. We pray that you would fill us up again, that you would reassure us with your comfort and with your peace. You know the things that are on our hearts this morning, the people who we worry about, the situations over which we don't have control, where we just have to have faith that your will and your way is what's best for us. Help us to remember, God, all of the times before when you came through for us. Help us to remember that when we thought we were lost in the darkness, you came and you shone a light. Help us to see ahead, God, to know that whatever comes next, you will partner with us through in each and every situation. If we simply just turn to you and acknowledge that we have a need for you to be there. We pray, God, because we trust in you, because no one else can help us but you, because we are humbled enough to realize that the state of our world, the state of our country, just the state of people's hearts is not in our hands, but only in yours. And Lord, we pray for goodness. We pray for peace, for restoration, for love, for healing. We pray, God, that in the waiting of all the situations, that you would be there with your comfort, that you would partner with us and walk through us, walk with us through them. And God, we pray together the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now is our opportunity to respond to God with gratitude as our ushers come forward for all.
Thank you.
you go with my love today. You go with the love of Jesus, which you carry with you to everyone you see. You go with the love of our church family, and may you go in peace and serve the Lord.